So yeah, dude, have you ever heard the difference between jelly and jam?
No.
Can't jelly my weenie in your butt. Welcome back. Welcome back to Two Boys, One Cup, formerly known as the Footy Fetish Show, where the fetish is real and the footy is soccer. It's about that time. We got to go over some World Cup. We got to review some things, look over some groups, see who's looking sexy, see who got left at the ball, see who's pumpkin, or see whose carriage turned into a pumpkin. There's been a few of those already. Some folks still haven't even gotten out of bed yet, so we'll go through all these groups for you. But first, I got to introduce my main partner in crime, Ocho, where you at?
Yeah! Back on the mic! It's a Mike Daddy. Mike Daddy, is always a pleasure. Pleasure to be here with you.
Pleasure to be here with you as well, sir. You ready to jump into this?
The pleasure is all mine, sir. Let's get into it. It's World Cup time.
Let's go. Group A, baby.
Starting out in Group A, let's go through these rankings real quick. Booty, what we got going on in Group A?
So far we're looking at the Netherlands in first with 4 points, Ecuador second with 4 points. They're actually tied on the goal differential right now, too. Ooh, boy. Senegal is then rounding out third place with 3 points. And then we have our friends Qatar that thanks for playing and showing up and hosting. But that's going to be about all from you guys. They're already out as we speak. So, man, this is not turning out the way we thought. We kind of thought Netherlands was going to not necessarily run away with this one. But, man, I will give us some cred, at least enough cred to buy a house here. Because we did mention to not look over Ecuador based on the fact that if you look at their conference, their league that they're coming in from qualification wise, they fuck around. They have to play Argentina. They have to play the Brazils. They have to play the Venezuelas, the Chiles. So you're looking at Colombia as well. So we're talking about a squad that has been overlooked for probably a few years in this qualifying at this point. If you said you have Ecuador on a bet, I'm going to need to see it in person, screenshot it to me, Footy Fetish Show, please send it to us, because I didn't see this coming. Definitely had Senegal advancing. And the matches that we've seen them, you know, perform, I mean, to tie the Netherlands, hey, man, that ain't nothing, you know, to be sad about, man. That's real deal stuff there. So what's your thoughts on this group, man?
Yeah, I mean, I couldn't agree with you more. I did not have Ecuador even touching the top two. I really thought they were going to kind of crash and burn. But, you know, as you said, they come from South America, so they have to play some giants from South America. This group will all boil down to match day three, and that is Ecuador versus Senegal. Senegal cannot afford a tie. They must win. Ecuador can tie the game in order to move on. And Netherlands, they can lose, I think, and still advance. Never mind. That's not a guarantee, because if Senegal – no, they have to win. They have to win. Anyway, Netherlands, I think we all predicted Netherlands would finish first. Ecuador-Senegal, man, this is going to be a really fun game to watch. I still think Senegal get it done, right? We're looking at the Africa Cup of Nation champions. I think they pull it off. If we saw how they played against the Netherlands, they lost that game in the last 5 minutes. They were in there with the Netherlands for the last 5 minutes. That could have easily been a draw, just like Ecuador. We're going to be very excited. I believe Enner Valencia subbed off and might have an injury.
Really?
Is injured. I'll have to double check that. But if Enner Valencia is injured, then I think this is a Senegal, because they depend on him to get goals. So here we go. 18 minutes. Latest on the Ecuadorian. Receives promising update after injury scare.
Okay.
Followed up.
That's good news, man, because he's been on fire.
He has been on fire. A knee injury. Had to be stretched off.
Yeah, see, you know, I hate when they do that, man. They say stretched off, and a lot of these times, if you notice, it's almost like a requirement they bring the stretcher out there sometimes. So it's like, you know, you could stub your fucking toe and you're gonna get it taken off on the stretcher. You know?
Ecuador fans can breathe easily, however, as he is expected to be fit in time for the big clash with Senegal.
Sweet,
All right,
sweet.
so that's
That's
going to
good to hear. So if that was the case, I'd say Ecuador is done then, if he weren't playing.
No, absolutely. Now they at least have a chance. I think this is a flip of the coin. I don't think we honestly can make a I would not bet on this game.
No. Or maybe even a draw. I
It's
kind of
gonna
like a draw drop on that one.
both teams, I think, are gonna go balls to the wall. I think they're
Yeah.
gonna win.
Yep.
Ecuador go for the tie and Senegal get the dub. You're gonna feel like dumbass, man. You're gonna feel
Yeah.
pissed
That
off.
wallet, that wallet's gonna be feeling like a dumbass.
Hey,
Tell
bro.
you what, that game as well, just a heads up for you folks, is on Tuesday the 29th. That's the 9 a.m. game.
What other games are me going on that day? We've got Group B. Glad you
Oh yeah, glad
asked.
you asked.
Let's go. Group B breaks down. It's a pretty tight group. Not really. England are in first with 4. Iran are in second with 3. USA are in third with 2. And Wales are in fourth with 1. This group can break down any which way you want to see it. Wales will be facing England. Iran will be facing the US. Whoever wins between those two, Iran and US, will advance no matter what. England might have a chance to not make it. No, they're pretty much in. Regardless,
Yeah.
France now has an opportunity to advance if they beat England. How about that for some fucking surprise ending?
Right.
Is it possible for Wales to beat England and then slide into the second place with US being number one? Because if the USA win, we get 5. If Wales win, they get 4. You now have a 5-4-4-3 table.
Yeah.
I think
Or,
the goal differential for England is too great. They have +4.
yeah, I
Wales.
was, yeah.
So Wales
Yeah.
beat England by at least 6.
Oh boy.
Ain't happening.
No.
Really quickly, we just saw the England versus USA game. Booty, I'm gonna get a timer going. Let's break this one down a little bit because this is the one we really care about. Buy or sell, good result for the American boys.
Yeah, you know, you got to feel a little disappointed because we didn't get the W, but at the same time, man, I have to say, man, I was actually really impressed that we actually showed up and all this shit talk that we've been hearing since this draw happened, about how we were going to get smashed and England. I saw Wayne Rooney was saying we're going to lose 4-0. Just the disrespect, man. I at least thought at this point that, you know, the British would be like smart enough to realize that we actually do have some quality on our squad, but apparently not. So in that case, I'm very impressed with the draw, actually. It's for us to show up and show that we belong there and to prove all them wrong, you know. Of course, you know, you feel that little voice in the back of your mind, man. The win would have really been nice, really would have looked nice for us, as far as our advancement out of the group, obviously. But I think we look at all the positives we took away from that game. You know, I don't think we took away any injuries,
Correct.
which we took away two last match, with McKinney. And wasn't there another injury, that we were worried about last match, or
Might have been yellow cards.
yellow cards? That's right. Yeah. So, I mean, you're looking at that. Also, good to see, you know, the one thing that we had a problem with from the first match was, hey, where's G Arena? Where's Aronson? We need that change of pace and you need the fresh legs. This was a match you had to do it. By the 70th minute, you started to see both sides started to slack off a little bit. You kind of started to see that in their eyes where both sides were okay with the draw. And then we saw our guys come in. We saw Aronson come in 77th. We saw, you know, Dest come out. We saw Shaq Moore go in. We saw Josh Sargent and Reyna come in the 80th. I would like to see them get in a little bit earlier. But you know what? Hey, we got what we wanted. So I, at the end of the day, man, I really felt with all the shit talking, with everything, how we were going to lean over and take it in the ass, we didn't. So to me, this was a win. Especially at the end of the day, World Cup, man, you got to get points. That's what it boils down to. You know, you cannot come away from these games without some sort of points. If you do, you will be going home. Good thing for Qatar, they're already at home. So just go ask them, obviously. But yeah, I thought this was great. Adams, I thought he had one of the best games I've ever seen him play.
Yeah.
I want to give a shout out to Robinson too, man. I felt like he was just so involved down the wing, man. And there were a few times, man, where he even got caught out of position. And he was hustling his ass to get back, man. Something you really love to see out of our boys, you know, especially against a squad like England. But we made England look pretty mediocre. We made England look like a team that, you know, a lot of people had England as possibly winning this whole thing. After that match, man, I don't think they're in the top four, top five of teams that could win this thing. So, yeah, every punch they threw us, man, we had a response for it. So I really enjoyed watching it. It was one of those few goalless draws I actually really enjoyed watching. And at the end of the day, too, around 70th minute, I went ahead and took a free bet and just put it on a draw, and then I ended up winning like, you know, an extra $50 from that. So I ended up doubling everything. So it was awesome. So I was happy.
Yeah. I mean, I liked a lot of the stuff you said. Mainly the one for me is Tyler Adams. You know, he's our captain moving forward. I'm glad they decided to make that decision ahead of the World Cup to make him the captain. He clearly has the respect of the team, and he's got that personality that you want out on the field. There was many times where he was chewing out Pulisic, and Pulisic kind of like nodded and was like, okay, sorry. Yeah, my bad. You did it. Yeah, you were right. You know, I got to give a shout out to that English back line, because without them, I think we walk out of there with an easy win, because their midfield, unimpressed. Their attacking four, unimpressed. Mount, Saka, Sterling, how much are those guys worth?
Yeah.
What did our backline, how much are they worth?
Right.
I mean, it just makes you wonder, like, is the EPL overhyped, or did these Americans step up to the challenge? I think these Americans stepped up to the challenge.
Yeah.
Every single one of them. The only player that I was a little disappointed with was Zimmerman. And it was only in the attacking phase. Whenever he had the ball at his feet, his distribution decisions were one, poor, and then the execution as well, also very poor. But as a back line, as a defensive back line, I got to give a ton of credit to those guys. They really hung in there. Zimmerman had a key block early in the game. I forget who took the shot, but he dropped that knee, kind of turned his shoulder, and it just, I mean, it deflected the ball. One thing that I'm really curious about is, what was the reason for starting Haji Wright?
Yeah.
And number two, why have we not figured out the correct substitution for Sergiño Dest? The first game we subbed in Yedlin. The second game we subbed in Shaq Moore. Neither of them looked impressed. Shaq Moore had an opportunity to hit a one-time cross late in the game to Pulisic, and he fucking took a touch. And the English back line was able to condense the space and were able to block the channel of the cross. Those are the kind of plays you just got to have the confidence. Take it off the first touch. Give your player the opportunity to at least have a chance on goal. Also got to give a shout out to the English crossbar, who blocked Pulisic's amazing left-footed shot. If that was a couple of inches lower, that is an absolute fucking banger. And we're electing Christian Pulisic president in 2026.
Absolutely.
I mean, so many good things. Also, my man of the match was Matt Turner. Kept a clean sheet, made some really key saves, and his distribution was excellent. Can't ask for much more than a goalkeeper to keep a clean sheet and not make any stupid mistakes. The one thing I do want to see Sorry, I dropped my pen. The one thing I do want to see is, I want to see Joe Scally sub in at right back for Dest. If Berhalter does decide to make that sub again. I think the McKinney and Death sub were to try and preserve them for the Iran game, just in case the yellow cards started to fly, because right now we have a lot of players. I think it all gets erased after the group stage, but we still had four players that were on a yellow from the first game. If they were to have received a yellow in this game, it would have suspended them from this third game against Iran. This is the game where we need to stack our chips. We need to make sure that we have our best starting lineup in that third game against Iran. Last thing I'm going to say here is, when you need a goal scorer and you don't bring the motherfucker who brought you to the World Cup, you look like a bad coach.
Yeah.
Where the fuck Ricardo Pepi is going to score a goal in that game if we have him? Guaranteed. That man can turn chicken shit into chicken salad with the services he gets, man. We got to have him in the game. We need him. That was a fucking mistake not bringing him, man. Fuck. I wanted to end on that, man. Needed Pepi. We needed fucking Pepi for that game.
It's amazing with all the talent that we have. We don't have like just a straight up, just pure, true goal scorer. And the closest thing that we had to it, you left him home.
Well, the closest thing that he had in Qatar was Josh Sargent, and he left him on the fucking bench.
Oh, yeah, that too.
Like, he brought him in. Brought him in the 83rd, along with Gio Reyna. Like, again, too late. Too late.
One thing I'll point out, and then we can move on.
Real quick, I do need to say sorry. I am impressed with 0-0. I gotta say that I am impressed with the 0-0. But like you said, it felt like we could have won that. All right, go on.
You know, when the game first started, you know, we were just letting them have possession, pass around the back. You already had that feel like, you know, oh, is this the shit that we're gonna do all day? We're already letting you guys do whatever the fuck you want. And you could already tell the back line as well for England kind of was feeling that vibe too. But as the game progressed, we got a little more aggressive. And we started to put that pressure on them and Maguire and Stones to make these passes. I like our chances every day, if that's what we're going to do against the squad. You know what I mean? To force them, that back line, to make the correct decisions. And then by the end of the match, man, I mean, we were pressing back at them. So I really didn't expect that. I thought we were just going to be a bunch of pussies, to be honest with you. And just take what we can get and get out of there happy. But we tried for the win. We really went for it. And like you said, that's why I felt like it felt like we should have won that game, because we were the better side. And we had them thinking we were even going to do what they thought we were going to do, and we didn't. So I do have to give old Greg credit for one thing, finally. This might be the first thing. I really thought he was just going to lay down and be a puss about it. We didn't. So I'm proud of that. I'm proud of our boys for that. So
yeah, I'm glad you said that. I'm proud of this result. And I got to give a shout out to Statboy Mattboy. He brought up a very good point. Ahead of this World Cup, do you remember who the two friendlies were?
Saudi Arabia and Japan.
Now, do you remember the two biggest upsets of this tournament?
Yep.
Saudi Arabia beating Argentina, Japan beating Germany. I'm starting to look at those friendlies and go, maybe we had those teams wrong. Maybe we pegged them as less of a team than they actually are. Those two teams have already had some of the biggest upsets in World Cup history.
Yep. And also, you got to think, you know, think about the time. What was that? That was in September, right? So in September, those two, and we've mentioned this point going into this World Cup many times. At that time, we were like scrambling to get everybody from their clubs and who can actually play in this game and who can't and who's hurt and blah, blah, blah. I can guarantee you they probably, both those squads, had most of their guys ready to fucking roll. So something else to think about.
No, that's spot on. I believe they share the same season as the MLS, which means that they have been rested, prepared since that game, since those
there
two.
You go.
So that's a good point. You can tell in those first two games that those two teams were very well organized and they knew exactly the game plan that they were going to bring against these two powerhouse teams that just happened to have a whole bunch of really good players that had never played together or had not played together in a long time.
Yep.
Shout out to the USA, man. I had a friend from England who commented on a post on Facebook saying, you know, that he was upset with the result of the game. And I was like, yeah, if I was an English fan, I'd be upset too, because you guys won 6-2 in the first game and then you tied 0-0. So yeah, you know, I would totally be upset. But as far as a USA fan, like, I'm sitting great. We're in third place. We got to play the weakest team in the group. And we didn't let the biggest team in the group score on us. Kept a clean sheet. I'm happy with that.
Yep.
And, I mean, I think you take that and you move. We move forward. Let's keep going. It's nothing more. I mean, I'm proud. I'm proud. We should have won, but I'm proud of the result. I think that's the best we can do right there.
Yep. Well said, sir. Especially, I think we've both been saying this. I know I have, man. This is not the World Cup that we need to go gaga over. It's the next one.
Yes. So
this is good experience building here. If we don't end up getting out of this group, we're going to be even hungrier next time, and it's going to be here on home soil. So
but
we will see.
With that being said, I think this will be tremendous for this team to just make it out the group. I think that achievement in itself will be a very big step for this team as a whole, and it'll be a good foundational memory experience for this team moving forward, because then they'll have that experience of what it takes to get out the group. So
yes, sir.
I like that thought right there of looking ahead to the future. This isn't the tournament that we need to be hypercritical about, but let's get out the group. Let's just get out the group. That's all we need to do.
Yes, sir.
Booty, what do we have going down in my favorite group in every tournament?
Group C. Man, another one. Another group that's pretty hot, man.
Mm-hmm.
We got Poland sitting in first. Who saw that? Big old Pole with 4 points. We got Argentina in second with 3. We got Saudi Arabia with 3. Mm. And we got Mexico with 1.
Mm.
I don't think anyone's had Poland on top of this group ever. But boy, oh boy, this is a fun one. Obviously, since the last time we recorded, Saudi Arabia pulls off the upset against Argentina. The 2-1 victory. Argentina looked super flat that game. It wasn't even a question of, oh, well, you know, Argentina at least showed up and they just didn't, it didn't happen. To me, they didn't look like they were even in that game at all. As far as mentally, just way too many chances that they weren't finishing.
Really? You know,
the goal that you had was a messy PK that was questionable. I mean,
but hold on. How many goals did they score that were offside?
Oh yeah, that's right. But then again, I mean, that's a mental thing. I think Di Maria was, or Lautaro was definitely off like 3 times, wasn't he?
I think the credit has to be given to Saudi Arabia for their discipline with their back line.
For pulling that lineup.
More than Argentina not being in the right headspace.
Okay. Yeah, I can see that too.
I don't like to make too many like very strong counters against you, but in that game, it looked like Saudi Arabia were prepared for Argentina to try and beat them into space. They caught them offside 4 times, and I think 2 or 3 of them were in on goal.
Yeah.
It was like, this game just went from 4-0 to 1-0 because of their offside trap.
Right.
I give a ton of credit to Saudi Arabia. They looked fresh. They looked determined. They looked ready. I will say, I do agree with you that Argentina looked sluggish, but not to a point where it was their fault for losing the game. I think we got to give a ton of credit to Saudi Arabia here. I don't know. That's my opinion. I want to give a ton of credit to Saudi Arabia rather than criticize Argentina for losing this game themselves. Do you see where I'm kind of coming from?
Yeah, no, I got you, man. No, I was being a little too harsh on the boys, but you know, with the Saudis too. I mean, it's a good point you brought up too. I mean, because you know what I was saying with the offsides. I mean, I guess it's, you know, you could look at it both sides. You know, I was looking at the other side. You know, where, oh, you're fucking up, but that's a good point, because if the Saudis are the ones actually pulling that line forward, catching them offside time after time, you know how that gets. When you've been caught offsides two, three times, you start to get even more frustrated, and you try to do even a little too much more than you should be doing, you know? But yeah, I mean, now that you're pulling it up, I mean, most of these cats for Argentina on the rating side of things, you know, strong sixes. So yeah, I can see your point.
I got to give a shout out to someone who's not on the score sheet but has been having a really good World Cup. Is this guy Mohamed Kano? He's a big, tall guy. He's like, they're calling him the Middle Eastern Pogba.
Oh,
it kind of, and he's kind of got like a Serge Milinkovic Savage type of build, as well as like the way he plays. Like, he's a very technical, but he's long and lanky, and he's a big body. He deserves a ton of credit for the success of the Saudi Arabian team, not to mention the two goal scorers. I mean, talk about some fucking incredible goals here. I mean, just so much good has been coming out of the Saudi Arabia team. And I hate to give Saudi Arabia credit, because they're basically like the little brother or the bigger brother to Qatar. It's the same thing, different country, you know, like,
yeah. Oil
money, don't care about women, don't care about gays, and they're probably breaking a whole bunch of human rights laws as we speak. You know, it's like, it's the same thing, but you got to give them credit. They're having a good World Cup right now. So shout out to Saudi Arabia.
Shout out to Vinny calling that one too, right?
He did. That's a good point. If we look at the African and Middle Eastern teams, some of these teams are taking advantage of their home field advantage, like Morocco today.
Yeah.
Didn't expect that. That crowd was very Moroccan today. That was great to watch. I really enjoyed that. But just to quickly round out this group, Mexico and Poland. I mean, holy fuck. Talk about a disaster from Mexico against Argentina. I really thought they had a chance there, but Argentina and Messi said, nah, not today, bro. Give me one shot. I'm going to end this game right now.
Yep. One shot.
That's all I need. Got to give Messi credit. And you might want to get this a headliner, man. I don't give Messi a lot of credit. That was fucking beautiful, man. That was fucking beautiful. I saw that shit live, and it was like, wow. I will give criticism to Mexico. They left him wide open on the top of the box, and the nearest player tried to press Messi, and I was like, bro, it's too late. You left him open, man. One touch finish, one touch, second touch shot finish. I mean, it was just chef's kiss. Oh, love it. Absolutely love it. Any last thoughts on Group C?
No, man, just to piggyback off what you're saying, man, with Mexico, I know, you know, obviously with this result, this usually happens anyway, but there's some talk about, you know, them keeping Tata, you know, was that the right decision coming into this? A lot of folks, obviously it's easy to say no now, but that was one of those questions that was out there. Secondly, yeah, that Argentina match, like you said, man, the only thing you can give Mexico credit for is they came out swinging.
Yes.
At first, they were coming at them first, but man, they fell apart, man. They fell apart, and they'll be going back home shortly, unfortunately. You know, it looks, well, no. Actually, they could still, no. Yeah, they could.
It's still possible for anyone in this group to advance.
Yeah, still possible, but pretty bleak. Going to have a win. And at this point, they're playing Saudi Arabia, right? Yeah.
Yes.
So, yeah.
Right, because Argentina, Poland.
Yep.
Mexico, yep. Saudi Arabia.
Woo-hoo. Oh, boy. That's going to be fun.
Yeah, just to quickly, just I think this is the last group that's got a CONCACAF team in it. Maybe we got one in Group F, but CONCACAF has had a very poor showing. Very poor showing this World Cup. Only one team has won. There are three draws and four losses, and there is a negative 12 goal differential.
Yikes.
That's all CONCACAF teams put together.
So yeah, there's only been three goals, right? Costa Rica, USA, and Costa Rica, USA, and Canada today.
Canada, right.
Yep.
Meanwhile,
already out.
Yeah, exactly. So just something to keep in mind moving forward. Boo! Group D. We're on to Group D. Group D is France, Australia, Denmark, Tunisia. France has got 6. They are already dominating this group. Australia's got 3 with the Socceroos getting a dub yesterday. Denmark has got 1, and Tunisia has got 1. Haven't really been watching this group too much, but France are really proving everybody wrong with 3 wins. I'm sorry, 2 wins. Mbappe's putting the team on his back. He's already got 3 goals in 2 games. Shout out to Mbappe, man. What a player. What a fucking player. Also got to give a shout out to Teo Hernandez, who is the first French player to have 2 assists in 2 games since like 1950. Very impressive. And he is taking full advantage of his brother being out injured. Hootie, do you have anything you want to say about this group?
Mbappe with the game winner in a really exciting match against Denmark. If you haven't seen it, if you can get a chance to go back and watch that one, real fun one. It was a draw for most of it. And then, of course, Mbappe puts it home, I think, 83rd minute, 84th, something like that. So, yeah, it was a really fun one. Like you said, man, that's the way to go about it, man. Especially after all the, you know, the negativity with him leaving PSG, him not leaving PSG, him going to Real Madrid, not going to Real Madrid. Oh, he's selfish. He's not selfish. You know, this is a great way to just shut everybody up on that one. So, yeah, let's see. So yeah, it was actually, so France was up 1-0, and then about 5 minutes later, 64th minute, and then looks like 7 minutes later, Christensen ties at 68th, and then Mbappe in the 86th to take it home. So, yeah, like you said, shout out to Mbappe, man. Way to shut some fuckers up.
Did you say Falkers?
Some Falkers with a hard L.
Hard L.
Hard L, like Denmark just got. Boom. Some Falkers.
Booty, how is Group E looking?
Oh, man, this one's a pretty crazy one as well. All the crazies are out for this cup. So we got Spain first with 4 points, Japan second with 3, Costa Rica in third with 3, and Germany rounded out in last with 1 point. They got some work to do, or they'll be going home, not advancing out of the group stage for the second World Cup in a row. Boy, oh boy. And of course, since we recorded last, Germany losing to Japan 2-1. They even had the lead on them, gave up 2 unanswered goals. Costa Rica, not a whole lot of folks seeing them coming, but went ahead and beat Japan today 1-0, the early morning game. But Spain, you know, when we were coming into this, we were just thinking about how all over the place that lineup is and how youthful that lineup is and if that was going to be, you know, their downfall. Was the youth going to be a problem? Were they going to be too young for this tournament? So far, I got to say, it's a really nice combination of old and young at this point. Yes. You know, the old guys with the experience, they're showing up for work and putting the young guys on their back, and it's in turn making those young guys play their hearts out. So it's a really nice little combination of a lineup. And it was something I felt like this was one of the biggest question marks as far as lineups coming into this. You know, where are the goals going to come from? Hey, first match they win 6-0. So.
7,
yeah, excuse me, 7-0. So, and in my opinion, they probably should have won today. They had the lead up until about the 83rd minute. So, probably should already have been advanced. As they're about 10 minutes away from advancing already out of this group. So, yeah, what you got?
I love what you said here about the mixture of young and old. You've got Carvajal well into his 30s, Busquets well into his 30s. I think their goalkeeper as well into the 30s, Jordi Alba well into the 30s. And then you have Gavi. Young, under 23. Pedri, young, under 23. Laporte, maybe. Let me get a double check on this. You've also got Danny Olmo, 24. Ferran Torres, 22. Pedri is 20. Gavi's 18. Laporte is 28. But this is a very, very evenly balanced squad. I love what you said there. Old with the young. I think that's really good to have, because you don't put all your eggs in the young basket. You don't put all your eggs in the old basket. You have this great balance of youthful energy and that old wisdom. And then the players with the old wisdom are in really key spots all around the field. Azpilicueta, over 30, another one.
Yep.
Really like what you said here. Costa Rica pulling off a fucking shocking upset today over Japan. Wow. Where the fuck did that come from?
Right? Especially after getting beat down 7-0. No, bounce back and beat Japan, shit.
Right? That's just keeping it alive, I guess. That just made the group very interesting. 4-3-3-1. Germany keeping it alive, getting 1 point. They've only got -1 goal differential. Spain is essentially through. All they have to do is win against Japan, which, hey, Japan's already beaten Germany, so fuck.
Yeah.
I'm not going to say anybody's through yet, because this is, I mean, the reason I said that was because of a +7 goal differential. But holy fuck, man. Can Costa Rica beat Germany? Can Japan beat Spain?
Yo. That would be some March Madness shit right there.
That'd be some fucking March Madness shit right there. I'm excited. Yeah. That one's too hot to touch right now. I think it would be better if we just moved on. How do you feel about that?
Yeah, so hot. Let's move on.
Oh, fucking hot.
Oh, so hot. Group F, baby. Break it down for us, Hugh.
F. People are getting F'd in Group F. And I tell you what, that Canadian head coach is going to regret opening his mouth to the media, because, man, payback's a bitch. That's all I'm going to say. Canadians got stomped out of the tournament 4-1 today to Croatia. And I'm going to look at this head coach here talking that shit before the game. The Croatian media picked it up, started printing it. There's a hilarious graphic. It's the Canadian head coach. He's naked. And they put this little tiny emoji over his penis, and it says something like, "Hey, we heard you want to fuck us. We hope you have the balls." Made his junk look really, really tiny. And it's like, well, I guess he didn't. So this group, let me just quickly go through the rankings. Croatia have 4 points in first. Morocco have 4 points in second. Belgium are in third with 3. And Canada, thanks for playing, 0 points. For as cocky as Canada was, they sure did bow out of this tournament pretty quick.
Yeah, and another squad that had a lead and just blew it. So they got a little too excited. I think it was their first goal, too, they even scored today. Shout out to Alfonso Davies, but didn't hold it. And one of the Croatian players, I can't remember which one, but afterwards he was saying how he's like, you know, you can't, like, talk shit like that to, like, a squad that's, like, proven. Like, this squad is a World Cup removed from being in the final.
Yeah.
You know? So, you got to watch who you're talking that shit to. Meanwhile, I think we need to talk about Belgium really quick. Speaking of young and old lineups, this one, they went ahead and put all of their eggs in the old motherfuckers basket. And we saw that today. Morocco going ahead and whooping them down 2-0. Mistakes by Courtois. De Bruyne is not fucking – I don't think he's shown up for the World Cup yet. Which is odd, dude. And the reason that it's that one stuck in my head, this was one I put a bet on, because I was like, it's just such a gimme. I did their first match against Canada. All it was De Bruyne had to have a shot on goal. That's it. So if I told you that before that match, they're going to play Canada, right? Which, no, you know, no disrespect to Canada, but come on, Belgium, Canada, right? I'll take that bet all day. Well, yeah. Dude, we're getting to like 70th minutes. Dude still hadn't had a shot on goal. And then you're looking at, I saw Lukaku come in today, man, who's fucking limping his ass into this tournament in the first place.
Yep.
They told him that if he wasn't going to be 100% healthy, don't bother coming. Well, he wasn't healthy the first match.
Yeah.
And then this one, he didn't come on until late in this one. So it's just, man, it's there's too many question marks now that we're seeing it. It was one of those things that was almost kind of hidden, you know? We saw how they've been doing in major tournaments lately. The last few major tournaments. So it was almost kind of just like hidden, like kind of disguised. And it's starting to kind of come out now, where they got some issues, man. They got tons of issues here. Don't think they're going to be able to clean it up either. So,
you know, what's interesting is that De Bruyne before this game made a comment. Somebody said, what are your chances to win the World Cup? He said, we're not. We're too old.
Yes.
And then after this game, Alderweireld made sure to make a – it was either him or Vertonghen made sure to make a comment like, yeah, we might be old in the back line, but we sure didn't score any goals in the front line. Maybe we're too old up there too.
Yeah.
Something like that. Like, he really didn't appreciate the comment that was made about him. I kind of want to go over this lineup real quick and just go through the ages of these players. I think Courtois might be the youngest player.
That's such a weird thing to say too, dude. Like, so you're telling me that you showed up to the World Cup thinking you're not going to win it? Like, I when I first heard it, I'm like, maybe he's saying that to, like, fire him up?
That's what I thought. I thought the same thing. And then you saw Alderweireld's comment. You're like, okay, clearly that was not an inside joke.
Right. Like, damn, dude, you really fucking – you showed up to the World Cup already knowing you're not going to win it. Okay.
Here we go. Number 11, Michy Batshuayi, 29. Thorgan Hazard, 29. Eden Hazard, 31. De Bruyne, 31. Amadou Onana, 21. There you go. Axel Witsel, 23. Castagne, 26. Alderweireld, 33. Vertonghen, 35. Meunier, 31. Courtois, 30. You've only got four players that are in their 20s, two of which are 29, and only one is under 23.
Yikes.
Dries Mertens, subbed in, 35.
I guess that was the question that, again, this is something that was kind of disguised in the last few major tournaments because they have Lukaku, but it was kind of like, I guess we're seeing now, who do you have after Lukaku? You know, I like Batshuayi, sure.
You know who it could be? Is this guy right here, Jeremy Doku.
Doku?
Yeah.
You seen him already?
I've seen him. He's a young, promising, he's 20 years old, young, promising striker / winger. Kids just got that it. Actually, you would remember him. You remember when Belgium played Italy in the semis?
Yeah.
This was that black dude that was out on the wing, causing chaos. Just a fucking terror.
I think okay. Yeah.
Drew a PK. I think there was a PK given in that game, and he drew it against. Fuck, what's his name? Was it Florenzi? I don't remember. Anyway, this kid has got the sauce. He should have been on the field today. It's a shame he isn't. Looking at the other half of this group, we've got Morocco, who, man. We got to give some shout outs to Morocco. They look good. This is a good team. Can't forget, man. Everybody keeps forgetting about Africa Cup of Nations. Everybody keeps forgetting, man. This team was a top four team in Africa Cup of Nations. This is a good squad. You know who didn't go to the Africa Cup of Nations? Hakim Ziyech. You know who got man of the match in this game? Hakim Ziyech.
Yep.
It's a good team, bro. This team could go far. This is going to be a very scary team. I would not want to play this team.
He also had a goal that was taken back by VAR, too. So there's really? Something to point out on that. Yeah. 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 He had a really nice one that was taken back. This is one of the few games today I actually did get to watch in entirety.
All right.
But yeah, go back and see if you can find that sometime. It was VAR. I forgot what VAR ruled. But yeah, they took it away from him right before the half. So Morocco actually should have been up by up going in the half.
Really?
Yeah. Let's see if that pops up somewhere up in here.
All right, hitting the play button. Play. Witsel, man, how about it? I didn't expect him to not only make the 26-man roster, but to be starting. That's impressive.
Yeah. They just rely on his movement and his decisions, man. I've obviously had him on fantasy and everything.
Right.
Got him on fantasy again. That number one spot team right here.
It's football. Soccer.
Easy.
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 Yeah, I think try like right before half. Pretty sure it was like 40th minute or something, 43rd maybe.
Ooh. Okay, I'm too far. I wonder if they're going to show it to us. What is that minute? Oh, that's the
I know. I hope they don't. They didn't take it out.
Looks like 51, maybe.
Damn, they skipped ahead. Huh? They're like, fuck this first half.
Ooh.
Oh.
Old by Courtois.
Courtois almost got Courtois'd. Damn.
There we go. 51. God. They might have not given it to us just for halftime.
Might have to go deep YouTube dive later.
Yeah, we'll do that later. I believe you. That would be. I mean, interesting. 3-0.
Yeah.
3-0. Yeah. Jeez.
But like you said, man, that's a motherfucker that you forget plays for Morocco. So, you know.
Don't forget about Hakimi on the right. Don't forget about Raoui on the left. I like my boy Amalia. He's over in the Belgian league and Nesseri. I think he's at Sevilla. Sofiane Boufal, another great player. But I mean, just like they got some ballers, man. They've been slept on. This is a good dark horse for this tournament to go forward.
Absolutely.
I'm sorry, Morocco, for not putting you in my top two. I'm gonna be honest. I was too emotional with CONCACAF. I put all the CONCACAF teams in the top two, except for Costa Rica, and I think I'm gonna pay for that. I really do.
Costa Rica might make it.
Yeah.
Shit.
But anyway, we've got two more groups that still have their second game tomorrow. That'll be Group G and Group H. Right now, Group G has got Brazil in first place with 3, Switzerland right behind them with 3, Cameroon and Serbia in last place with 0. Footy, how is Group H looking?
Group H, we got Portugal with 3, Uruguay with 1, South Korea drawing Uruguay. They have 1, and then Ghana, man, poor Ghana, they could still do this, but they got to pull off a win. They got 0 points right now. Yikes. Going back to Brazil, Hugh.
Yes.
Your boys.
Yes. So
what are they going to do if folks, if you haven't heard?
Oh, yes.
Neymar's
injury. He tweaked his injury. The rumors are that there's a chance he plays tomorrow, but it's highly unlikely. Definitely should be back by the end of the group stage. Might be able to make it for the third game. But the plan that is circulating on the internet is that Neymar will be subbed out. Fred will be subbed in, but not as a center attacking mid. Fred will be playing as a center defensive mid next to Casemiro. And then Paquetá will be starting as the number 10 for Brazil behind Richarlison and in between Rafinha and Vinicius Jr. Same backline as before. Booty, while we're talking about this team, let's just quickly give a glance over to your fantasy team. We haven't really mentioned them. Thiago Silva pulling it out with a 30 fucking 6, man. Still got it in the tank. Booty's team right now is in first place. He made some very, very good picks. Number 1 being Kimmich, number 2 being Casemiro, and number 3 being Modric. All 3 players having a total of about 110 points, which is extremely incredible. You'll be lucky to get about a 20 to 25. That's a good score. He also drafted Pulisic, Di Maria, Jordi Alba with a 41. Great score. As well as Alderweireld for Belgium. Booty, what was your strategy drafting this team?
So I was, you know, in this particular league, I'll try not to go, you know, too in depth on the scoring, but it's actually pretty valuable to grab these guys, these defenders, either to me, grabbing defenders and grabbing guys who are heavily involved in the build up of play, or in the possession, or in the decision making, really. Those are the guys that you're going to see, you know, a lot of points from. You know, your first thought, fantasy soccer, is to go grab the goal scorers, obviously the big names. But the way you look at it also with this group, you know, you get some points for clean sheets too. So it's an easy, a lot, not saying every single time, but it's pretty easy to look at a weak group, grab a goalkeeper, grab a couple of defenders that are going to go against some squads that, you know, they probably aren't going to have a lot of trouble with. So, for example, you know, what, first game, Brazil, they play Serbia, no offense to Serbia. Brazil should win that all day, right? That's a good chance they're going to have a clean sheet on that. So, boom, Thiago Silva right there. Jordi Alba, he's a guy that he just, we were saying before the pod, he's just a dude that next time you watch Spain, I mean, he's literally all over the field. He's everywhere. Dude's old as fuck, and he's like the fucking roadrunner, you know? So,
Clean sheet Costa Rica
again. So there you go. Then you had Ochoa with Poland. Well, you know, no offense to Poland, obviously that this changed a little bit as of yesterday with Poland winning. But before that, Lewandowski's never even had a World Cup goal. After Lewandowski, who the hell is scoring goals? So another one that I was like, that's a really good chance to have a clean sheet there. Got a little dicey though with a PK that Ochoa saved. So I almost had to bite my tongue there. But yeah, I mean, it's a good start. And also then you want to talk about, you know, my midfield, Kimmich, a guy who can play multiple different positions and he's asked to do multiple different things. So he's always going to be involved in build up as well as sometimes defense as well. Then you have Casemiro as well, you know, another guy that they rely on for the build up of play. And Modric, I mean, hey, Modric, this dude is, if you go back and look, he's gotten a man of the match in every, at least one match in every major tournament they've been in, I think the last like four.
Yeah.
So he's just a guy that's essential to that squad as well. So.
Well said. One of the picks I really liked was Pulisic as well, because, you know, he's one of those picks that everyone's like, oh, you know, Mr. USA, but you forget that everything is going to be flowing through him for Team USA in the attacking phase.
Yeah. And
he fucking put on a show against Wales. He looked really good, not to mention he had that assist to Tim Weah. So that's points on the board right there. Just a really good overall squad here. From your booty. I'm like in fifth or sixth place out of nine, so I've got some climbing to do, but I got to pat myself on the back. I drafted Cody Gakpo early on, and he is now 2 goals in 2 games. So we're still looking good. We got a good solid squad lined up. Booty, I think that'll do it. We didn't really touch on Portugal. I mean, Group H and Portugal, Uruguay, South Korea, Ghana. We're gonna be able to touch on these more after this. They play their second game, but this group to me is still wide open. Like, this is anyone's to take. Just because Ghana has not won a game doesn't mean they can't win this next one and give themselves an opportunity to advance. Who do you think has got a greater chance to advance out this group? Uruguay, South Korea, or Ghana?
And, you know, I like Uruguay, but at the same time, it's like I feel like they're also putting a lot of eggs in, you know, the older basket. You know, they're still relying on goals from Suarez and Cavani. I think they brought Cavani in off the bench, though.
Yes.
The way Ghana looked against Portugal, for the most part, I didn't think they looked that bad, you know, for at least a good portion of the game. I think I'm going to go Ghana.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. I was going to say the same thing.
Yeah. I think, you know, South Korea, I just feel like if they had Son, it'd be different. Uruguay tying South Korea, that doesn't impress me either. And with that being said, to hang with Portugal, the way Ghana did for the most part of that game. I mean, that's impressive in itself. Love Ronaldo, by the way. Big shout out. He's now 5 World Cups he's now scored in. But I think that that penalty was a little bit of a gift. So take that away.
Sold it.
And we got a tie game. And they almost gave it away at the end. So I really think Ghana, if they can get over, you know, some, as you know yourself as a coach, it's sometimes hard to get over those heartbreakers. If they can just see past that, move on, I think they can definitely beat. I think they can beat South Korea for sure. Uruguay might be a little tougher, but they're definitely capable.
Agreed. Well, we've reached the last group of our group stage preview review. How about we close it out?
Don't close it out with some shout outs. You want to go first?
I've got a good shout out. I'm going to shout out my sister, who is no longer a Bartlett. She is now a Bert. Shout out to the Berts for hosting the Bartlets for Thanksgiving. It was a Bert and Bart family reunion, and they did a great job. We were there for 5 days and had food and drink and good laughs. It was a good time. And, I wish them the best in their marriage.
Hell yeah. Shout out to Coco. Congrats, Coco. I'm going to shout out my wife. It was her birthday today.
All right.
She is turning super old.
Don't tell her that.
Dude, it's funny. I always make fun of her because she is older than me. She's 2 years. She's 2 years older than us. And dude, for the longest time, I was, you know, making fun of her. And then, like, one day she's like, wait, how old are you saying you are? And I was like, at the time, I was like, 31. She's like, you're 32. I'm like, what? I'm like, no, I'm not. So I didn't even know my own damn age. But no, she's freaking awesome. She's one of those people, like, when we first met, I actually felt, like, a little nervous. And nobody really ever makes me feel nervous. So I knew it was definitely meant to be, for sure. And she's been a great mom. She's had a lot on her plate. I mean, it's enough on your plate already just to deal with me on a daily basis. So, she's been really awesome. We had a great day today. So shout out to wifey.
Shout out to Kimmy.
The show.
Yeah. Happy birthday to Kimmy from the Footy Fetish, from the Ocho, from the Mike Daddy, a special happy Thanksgiving. I still need to do your happy birthday post on the Footy Fetish, and I am so sorry I have not done that. I'm going to try and find time.
Oh, you're good, man.
I'm just going to post it randomly, and we're just going to make people say happy birthday to you on your non-birthday. And it's going to be a surprise for you.
one of my favorite writers, you know, Lewis Carroll, Alice in Wonderland, right?
Right.
Happy un-birthday to you.
I'm going to have people texting you happy birthday, not knowing when your actual birthday is, and it's going to be hilarious.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I don't know if you remember in Alice in Wonderland, Mad Hatter's like, yeah, happy unbirthday to you, Alice. And she's like, what? And he's like, well, everybody has an unbirthday. They have 364 of them.
Yeah, no, I'm not doing that. I'm going to make that it's your birthday in the next week. And they're going to be texting, yo, dude, happy birthday. And you're going to have to go, damn it, it's not my birthday, but Hugh played a trick on me.
By the end of the day, I'm going to be like, thank you. Thank you so much.
Yeah, you're just going to start saying thank you, and people won't know the difference.
Might tell people to start Venmo me beer money, you know?
Dude, I might do that. I might be like, yeah, this is an appreciation post for Booty. Send him a couple of bucks. We might just do that, man. Somebody's going to catch on and be like, wait, what? That's not Booty's birthday? He's like, yes, it is. Shut up.
it was funny. Napoleon did that one time. We were just like, I just go check my Venmo and like right after my birthday, it was like, you know, $20 for whiskey. It said, like, go get whiskey.
All and right.
Russ did it one time because he's like, I want a subscription to Kevin. Anytime Kevin texts you ridiculous shit, you better send it over.
Oh my god.
That's like, if it's been a week or so, he'll just be like, yo, brah, pay for this fucking subscription. What the fuck? he sent me $10.
That's fair. That's a worth it. That's a worth it subscription.
Oh yeah, I mean it's it never runs out of material.
No, content. So, for
absolutely,
content for days.
Well, shit, Holmes, that'll about do it. We will hop back on with you ASAP. And we got the knockouts coming up, so we're super excited. Fuck Qatar. This has been the Footy Fetish Show, where the fetish is real and the footy is soccer. Peace out, Boy Scouts.